Whether people are healthy or ill, they keep track of their physical state. There are at least 8 ways of getting information from the body. Seeing, hearing, smelling, touching, tasting, proprioceiving, symptom perceiving, and measuring. People monitor their physical state. They can allocate their attention to their body. The body provides a constant stream of information, but most information remains outside the awareness. When people become aware of physiological processes by sensations, meaning that the information is in the focus of the attention, the information about the body is interpreted. This interpretation may lead to psychological experiences, such as emotions, and to behavior. Especially changes in the body attract attention. Changes can only be judged against the baseline. They are deviations from normal. Besides sophisticated and well-informed interpretations about the origin and meaning of symptoms, people may have all kinds of beliefs and simple heuristics to interpret the body information. A belief that may lead to an interpretation may be, when body tissue is red, it indicates an infection. Or a simple heuristic that may be applied is, when body information manifests after stress, it is caused by stress. Let's first take a look at the different ways of receiving body information. People look at themselves. They inspect the exterior of their body. They may observe their eyes, that may be yellow, red, or watery. They can observe their skin and interpret what they see, for example, a well-known eczema or a new rash. They may look at their nails, or they may watch their body shape and fat layer. When they attend to specific features, they easily conclude on the meaning of those features. People also hear their body. They hear themselves cough and then conclude about a cause. They may hear a constant tone or whistle. They may listen to their own breathing to conclude about their physical stamina. And with some embarrassment in public, they may hear their intestines. People smell their body. They may smell their feces or urine and conclude about an unusual smell, change in smell. They may smell their own sweat to conclude on their level of stress. People may also get body information from touching it. The fat layer may be touchable, muscles may feel hard, and a lump may be touched as long as it attracts attention, just to check it almost unconsciously to track possible changes. People also know their body by its taste. They taste earwax, the taste of salty sweat, or of blood iron. They all tell about the body. By proprioceiving, we feel our posture and muscle tension. It tells us where our limbs are and how our muscles are in use. Besides, through those senses, we can experience a range of different physical symptoms, such as types of pain, like nerve pain, colic pain, burning pain, stabbing pain, nagging pain, itchy pain, but also nausea, dizziness, tickling, stiffness, and many more other symptoms. Another source of information on the body comes from measurements. Blood pressure, temperature, heartbeats, and body weight can easily be measured and monitored. But through blood measurements, also hundreds of advanced measurements can be done. And a complete body scan can provide even more information on the body, from inside the body. Thus, people are exposed to body information every day. That is no problem. The power of this information lies in its interpretation, once people allocate attention to it. All these symptoms or signals or measurements of symptoms are given meaning. This may have strong consequences on people's decision-making, on how they feel, and on what they do. There are various sources of how people interpret all the information. Two clusters of beliefs about the reality that are part of the interpretational framework are central: illness beliefs and medicine beliefs. Illness beliefs are ideas of people about specific diseases. How serious is the illness? What is the cause? And what can be done? For example, it makes a huge difference between thinking that a headache is caused by a hangover or caused by a brain tumor. In addition, people's ideas about medicine play a role. For example, when one uses medication to lower stomach acid production, thinking that a headache is a side effect of the medication may lower adherence to the medication. We can further understand symptom perception in a broader model of behavior, in the control theory. In this cybernetic model, the output of a system leads to consequences that are detected. This is the input that is fed back. In the comparator, this input is compared to what is desired on the basis of values and goals. When necessary and effective, the output is adjusted to change the consequences. This general model can also help to understand the influence of symptom perception on behavior. In this cybernetic model, the output are health behaviors. These behaviors can be associated with pathological processes that are detected, interpreted, and compared to values or goals. When the symptoms or signals indicate a threat of the value of health, the behavior may be adjusted. For example, the behavior may be the intake of medicine to treat an objective physical condition. This may influence, well, lower pathological processes and thus the subsequent symptoms. These symptoms are interpreted, for example, as a sign of recovery, and this may reinforce the medicine intake. Another example concerns smoking tobacco. A smoker smokes cigarettes, which is the behavior. This leads to tissue damage in the lungs, the pathological process. This leads to the symptom of coughing, which is detected and fed back. The cough is interpreted, for example, as caused by smoking. This notion is compared to one's goals and values, for example, the value of good health and the goal of not endangering one's health. In an integrated system without goal conflicts, this will lead to adjusting the behavior, that is, quitting smoking. However, it is possible that there are conflicting values and goals that may want to preserve the unhealthy behavior. The smoker does not want to quit because it feels good to smoke, which is related to a hedonistic value. In this case, the cybernetic system can engage in defensive downregulation, strategically or functionally changing the input so that it is no longer discrepant with goals and values, so that the behavior can be preserved. There are several types and mechanisms of defensive downregulation of symptoms. The first is to not attend to symptoms, try to ignore them. The second is to reinterpret symptoms so that they are not caused by the behavior. The third is to acknowledge that the symptoms are caused by the behavior, but that the behavior is not under control of the person, like being addicted. This mechanism of biasing and distortion of symptom perception is a normal phenomenon in all unhealthy behaviors. People try to not change their eating pattern despite their intestinal problems. They do not go to the dentist despite tooth problems. And they do not consume less alcohol despite the hangover. When people interpret a symptom, they can start to evaluate it. How bad is it? And how does it compare to my goals and values? However, people may also stay genuinely uncertain about the cause of their symptoms. They may fear different options, but cannot decide what is wrong with their body. Therefore, they keep on looking for clues. When does it occur? What did I do right before it? When were the symptoms absent? They may mentally go through all possible causes and see how their symptoms fit the causes. They more strongly attend to the symptoms and they try all kinds of interpretations of the symptoms. This can lead to hypochondriac complaints, getting fearfully obsessed with physical symptoms. With regard to this uncertainty, we can also use the complete cybernetic model in a different way. In this model, a person may engage in help-seeking behavior to lower the uncertainty about one's symptoms. Test results, for example a diagnostic test, may not help to explain the symptoms, and uncertainty remains, which preserves the help-seeking behavior. Typically, in the case of unexplained medical symptoms, test results will not explain the symptoms and uncertainty remains, and thus the motivation to seek help remains. The test results may often indicate what is not. For example, it is not cancer, it is not fibromyalgia, it is not a fever. Instead, these diagnostic tests may be designed to show what it is, where a symptom does come from. For example, from muscle tension, conditioning, or attentional processes. Thus, basic uncertainty may be caused by the lack of an interpretational framework of truly experienced symptoms. On the other hand, there are physical conditions and pathological processes that can have negative consequences but no symptoms, such as osteoporosis, hypercholesterolemia, and hypertension. Still, these conditions may need treatment. Once people know that they have a certain condition, they may start to attribute physical symptoms to this condition. In these asymptomatic conditions, this is an illusion. Indeed, with regard to hypertension, high blood pressure, research shows that most people do not know how their true blood pressure is. Still, people may think they see a relation between the condition and their symptoms. For example, a person who learned he has osteoporosis may now attribute light muscle pain to osteoporosis. Similarly, a person who has been diagnosed with hypertension may interpret a headache on Monday evening now as a sign of high blood pressure. These mistaken or illusory attributions can have real effects on patients' decision-making and behavior. When people experience no symptoms, they may feel relieved and may stop taking medication because it seems not necessary anymore. Or people may or may not consult a doctor because of mistaken attributions. Here are some data from a sample of 176 patients with mild hypertension, all treated for this condition. The table shows the percentages of patients who think that each of the six symptoms or experiences is an indicator of their blood pressure. In the middle column, it shows that when people feel strong, 59% interprets this as a sign of normal blood pressure. The right column shows that almost 25% of the patients attribute feeling sweaty and a pounding heart as a sign of high blood pressure. There is a substantial chance that these attributions are mistaken. Patients may also perceive causes of their symptoms and therefore of their conditions. For example, a patient may experience anger and a slight headache after a busy day and think that 1. The anger caused the blood pressure to rise and 2. The blood pressure led to the headache. Here are some data on patients' perceptions of the relation between emotions and their blood pressure. Feeling happy and relaxed are seen by most people as related to a good blood pressure, while negative emotions, such as being angry and stressed, are seen as related to high blood pressure. This table shows that patients also have ideas about how the day or the time of the day are related to blood pressure. Again, all these hypertension patients' perceptions of causes and correlates may be mistaken, but they do influence people. How they feel, relieved or depressed, whether they use their medication or not, or whether they seek help or not. These mechanisms play a role in asymptomatic diseases, but also in symptomatic diseases. For example, in lung diseases, such as asthma, patients may experience true physical symptoms, but still be mistaken about what these symptoms actually mean. In addition, they may attribute other symptoms that objectively have nothing to do with their asthma to their asthma. To conclude, people have symptoms all the time. That's normal. The body signals in many ways its functioning. Interpreting symptoms and interpreting signals and measurements is normal and desired. It can help us to survive. But only when we attend to them, interpret them in useful ways. Healthy people and patients can also interpret symptoms and signals in such a way that their health is undermined. People may make decisions based on illusory relations between symptoms and conditions. They may experience fear because of this, and they may fail to take the right measures. Psychologists can support people in this area to make the right interpretation of symptoms and signals, although medical knowledge here is indispensable.